Good afternoon. I'm glad I scared you all enough to stay. I'm certain there were people thinking, oh, I've got this really important text now. I need to get back to school and do stuff. I am pleased. The lure of a magic wand obviously is a lot stronger than I thought this afternoon. It is a little bit scary because nobody really knows what I do. So I'm going to give you a quick whistle-stop tour of who I am. This will be about, 5 minutes worth of boring. And then after that, then we'll go on to some exciting bits. Okay? So I have the most ridiculous job title known to man. I'm an executive head teacher. I'm hearing the gasps of shock and awe. It normally means that you just get shouted at by lots of people, and that's what happens to me on a daily basis. I have a head teacher, and I have a head of school, and I have deputies and all manner of that lovely stuff underneath, but I still seem to be running around and blocking toilets, so I'm not quite certain where the executive bit has kicked in. Waterside... Oh, I don't even do the executive toilets. That's what's really worrying. Waterside is split up into 5 bits, and so Waterside provides support for primary children with SEMH, or what used to be called SEBD behaviours. I took over Waterside 3.5 years ago. It wasn't working particularly fabulously. It now is working particularly fabulously, so I'm really proud to stand here and tell you that. But we have an outreach service that goes out. It's free at within Greenwich for any primary child that's displaying behaviours within class that are coming to cause for some concern. If they undergo an EHCP, we will help that school try and work out what's going wrong with that child, why they're acting the way they are. We did have a huge team at the very beginning, but because of budgetary cuts, that team has been cut and cut and cut and cut and cut and cut. And so we're now down to 10. I'm number 11, so if that child is really interesting and that head teacher is crying at me over the phone, I turn up. Very few head teachers don't cry to me over the phone, and I turn up quite a lot. We also do the positive handling. So some schools do team teach. Team teach isn't accredited under the built code of conduct. So we do approach, and we train everybody within Greenwich in the approach method of positive handling. It's not necessarily always that positive, but we do positively handle people on a regular basis. Since September 2018, we support 170 children a week with a staff of 10. That means they're really busy. Really, really busy. And I look after them as much as possible. Under the next is the exclusion provision. So unlike some boroughs, Greenwich still provide education for primary children if they've been excluded for more than 6 days. And if they are, they get to come and play with me for the rest of their exclusion. It also enables me to hold on to children who are causing real difficulties for some schools and for me to help those schools understand why that child is doing what it's doing. We are unusual because we have to work with every single agency, and by every single agency there isn't an acronym, a set of letters, a Scrabble board that I don't play with on a daily basis, and I have a really good close personal relationship with social care. They don't particularly enjoy that close personal relationship, but I really do value that close personal relationship. I'm the only head teacher that sits on the Fair Access panel, and I sit on both primary and secondary. All the others do it once a year. On a lovely little rota. I have to sit every fortnight on primary and every other fortnight on secondary. So I get to see how interesting the borough is becoming. We are the only accredited nurture provision within London. So if you've got a nurture unit in your school and you're calling yourselves a nurture unit, you are liars. You have not done the full 2-year accreditation. Just saying, you can all wander around and put it on your lovely websites, but I've got the plaque. If you haven't got the plaque, don't come crying to me, ladies and gents. And we're the only one in the UK that's SEMH, which means that Nurturing Schools UK use me a lot to sit on a lovely pamphlet going, oh, look at that, it's nurture, while children are spitting behind my head. We use it for children who are displaying very severe attachment issues within school, which have included huge amounts of violence. They stay with us for a maximum of 4 terms in that area, and they either then transfer into the main building or we'll have worked our magic and they go back into mainstream. We opened in September 2018 the Nook. You'll have noticed that there is a pattern here of nut sounds. This is mainly because I couldn't be very imaginative, I've got to be honest. We opened that on the request of the assistant director. We have children within Greenwich, and I'm sure you have them in your borough as well, that have been out of education for huge amounts of time because school can't manage them. So we have children who have got ASD diagnoses or are displaying ASD behaviours and traits. Those children probably have been out of school for a minimum of 18 months. I have a young man who's year five who's been out for 26 months before he arrived to me. He's now been in school every single day. He is a very unusual young man because he's known to the prevent team and because he's not allowed access to the internet because he hacked his previous school and locked them out of their computers and locked their doors. And he goes on the dark web at home. So he's no longer allowed anything with the internet. But if you annoy me enough, I am going to give him your details and then I'll have sorted my budget problem. So think on before you criticise me. Waterside is the main bit of the building, and for them to gain access in Waterside, they have to have an EHCP. I usually get to know about those children fairly early on because of the other work that I do. There are eight in a class. It's in the most salubrious part of Greenwich. It's in Plumstead. If you don't know where that is, you don't really need to go that far. I can say that because I came from a posh school. So before I became the head of special, and I think we can all see why, I was the head of an incredibly posh school in Wales, fourth form entry with my own bees, my own trees, my own farm. I had champagne tents for sports day. The WI came and told me what flavoured water I was supposed to have that season. That's how posh I was. And I gave that up to go to the glitz and the glamour of SEMH, where on my first morning I was called a mother effing lots of things, and I didn't quite know what I was supposed to do with that. Being Welsh and Welsh-speaking, I just assumed that was very South East London. I would embarrass myself and do my Dick Van Dyke accent for you, but I'm not going to, because it's going to be on video and I really do not need that to come back and bite me. We use a variety of techniques within Waterside to try and help our superheroes. So if you arrive at Waterside as a child or as a parent, you are issued with a cape and a mask, as a real superhero would be given. You pin four of your most interesting behaviours onto your cape, and we work on those behaviours every week. If you manage to show that you can manage those behaviours, we will fly around the building. Everybody flies, from premises manager right through to me, with a cape and a mask, and we take off the behaviour that you have accomplished when we, as a community, have agreed that you've demonstrated it. That's really useful because it helps the children do a little bit of self-assessment. It also makes them think that I've got behaviours that I can never change. I've never changed mine since 2015 on the back of my cape because I'm really, really practically perfect and it's very difficult for me to improve on that. I'm really, really sorry. It doesn't look very much like a primary school from the outside. It does look like somewhere that you would keep your bins, but that's because where we are. But if you come in, it looks exactly like a primary school and my children do incredibly well, which you'll see at the end of this presentation. We are unusual within SEMH because we like to return them back to mainstream. Waterside was the place where children were sent and they didn't come back out. They do now come out quite a lot. And they are really nice and well behaved. We were at Young Voices last Monday, which for a mainstream school is a ridiculous amount of time to keep them sane. You try doing that with 24 of them who can swear, spit, bite, kick, punch, and have no fear of anything from 1 o'clock in the afternoon till 10 p.m. My staff are amazing for being able to do that, and I drank a lot in order to make certain the pain went away. We have been really good at returning them, and 56 of our kids are currently either in a mainstream primary or in a mainstream secondary and are doing incredibly well. We do have our failures. I can't stand here and tell you that every single child works. The reason it doesn't work for some children is that the school that they've gone to has forgotten what they were and then has wondered why they've suddenly become interesting when they haven't followed the processes that we told them to. We also train all of our parents in behaviour. If they come to the school, they have to learn how to say the magical big word of no and mean it. They do a 7-week accredited programme, and at the end they get a certificate. We shake hands, it's all rather lovely. If they don't attend within those 7 weeks, I talk to my lovely friends at social care and we stop their benefits until they turn back up. That really does help. That really, really, truly does help. King's Oak is the secondary version. It wasn't called King's Oak up until September the 1st last year. It was called Moat Bridge, and I was asked by the borough to take it over. Within my first 20 days of being there, I had Ofsted come to monitor, as it was in RI. That was a pleasant experience for me, as you can imagine. And actually it was a really pleasant experience for me. The lovely Janet and I got on incredibly well by the end of that day. And she wrote me a lovely letter telling me that she could see improvement, but she couldn't take me anywhere out of RI. And I was quite pleased with that, because at that point, I didn't even know what the school looked like really well. We are waiting for Ofsted to return, and I'm hoping that they're going to see the huge improvements that we've put in place, because we've worked damn hard since January. We've had to federate the two schools together for a really boring reason, that I can't control two budgets without it being under one heading, so we have to now be federated. And we changed the school name because the children didn't like the name. I've now amalgamated two governing boards. I did that in 6 weeks. And I'm still standing. Barely. So that's me done. That was lovely. Thank you for all sitting there and waiting. Your ones are at the back. No? Oh, you haven't learnt anything. So, as we're doing about happiness and well-being, we have an ethos at Waterside and now at King's Oak that we want school to be fun. Because most of these children that you have got rid of out of mainstream because they've been interesting, we have to take and make school work for them. They need to find that they can learn. They need to find that school's a fun place to be. So we really proactively work hard on our happiness. And we are proud to be one of the very few schools in the UK that's accredited as being a happy school. And we've been accredited by the Professor of Happiness. And he is a real professor. I'm not making this up. I haven't had a moment. He's got his PhD from Oxford University, and he's studied how happiness changes the brain. And he's got this whole pack that we had to do. And my school is a happy school. So we have happiness days throughout the week where we celebrate each other and we celebrate things that are going both inside and outside of the school. And my children have to be able to feel that they can express some of those emotions that they've tried to keep in a safe and safe environment that makes them feel that they could actually lose their temper but know that nobody's going to get cross. School has to be safe for your families as well. So if your school has this whole open door policy and says that it's welcoming, how welcoming is it? Have you tried ringing up your secretary when you're outside of your school, like on a course, and you go, all right, on the other end of the phone? Or it sounds very deadpan. If they do that, that's not really welcoming you into the school, because that could be the first point of call for you. What about when they come in? You know, when you get people through your door, do you offer a coffee, a tea, a water, a different type of tea? Do you offer them a seat? Do you offer, make certain that they can use the sign-in screen, because we've all now gone electronic and we expect everybody in the world to be able to type their name in, and then you discover that most of the people can't spell their own name. You have to think about what your ethos looks like as you come into school. So our websites give you a flavour of what you're going to get at both schools before you arrive. So this is Waterside's website. I think you can decide that we are superheroes in our website. Everything is themed throughout the building like that. And King's Oak's website is very grown up. Doesn't make you think that you're going to a special school. It actually makes you think that this is a really lovely place to go to, which it is. But you may think that parents would like a prospectus and want to come. And actually, unfortunately for some parents, they do look on Greenwich websites and find my schools and think that they can send their beautiful, well-behaved, well-mannered children to me, and then I have to explain that that's not where they should be going, and let me send you somewhere else to go and help. We have a big mission in our buildings, that we have to go in being the happiest version of us possible. And that's difficult. I know how that feels. You get up of a morning, nobody's emptied the dishwasher. The dog is cross-legged in the kitchen waiting to go out. You've discovered that the things you'd asked to be done by your other half have not been done. You open bags to find more bags that have not been emptied. You find dirty washing in places that you weren't expecting dirty washing. And this is all before 7:30 in the morning, and you're supposed to be a very well-rounded professional. Or it's just me then going through. Gosh, you can all teach me then. You can all teach me how your lives are so perfect. It is tricky to maintain your happiness level, but anybody that comes to work with me has to have a happy side. I expect you to have a wobble. Don't look at me and think that I'm that evil that you have got to walk around with a fixed grin on your face 24/7. We all have challenges, but our children deserve the best version of us. They deserve to know that we are approachable, happy, friendly people. And the only way I can describe what it's like for me is to show you the next video. And I showed this on my very first day at Waterside when they'd come from a very different regime to the regime I've put in place. And you can imagine the result after that video when you've watched it. Hopefully, if technology works. I do have my tutu with me. I dressed up as that young lady on my initial opening gambit for Waterside because that's how I feel school should be. It should be unbridled joy. You shouldn't give a damn about what anybody else is thinking about what you do. You should go and do it. And if it wobbles, it wobbles. Nothing in there fell down. Nothing in there could be replaced. Nothing in there couldn't be fixed. That's school. If you want school to be regimented and never change, well, you can make it that way, but it won't be a fun place to be, and staff won't stay, and children won't be joyous, and parents won't talk about you in that shock and awe that you'd hope that your parents would when they see Ofsted. You know, they need to know that school is a human place, that things will go wrong, and that you're happy to say, oh, it's gone wrong. The amount of parents that have greeted me in this purple tutu, oh, countless. In fact, some of them get quite despondent when they've booked a meeting with me and I'm not wearing it, but it does depend on the outfit. I don't want to clash too often. I really don't. So, I'm going to talk to you about how you can improve your well-being when you have got some very interesting people to play with. And you'll notice I haven't used the magic N-word. Considering I've got nut words for everything, I have not used the nut sound for naughty. There is no naughty children. Shock. Good God, woman, in that mustard top, you could have looked a bit more shocked then instead of writing that down. I mean, do you think I can't see you? This isn't television. I can see you. It's called interaction. It's live. It's fabulous. The N-word for naughty does not apply to children. Naughty is going into the staff room and eating a biscuit when you've told everybody you're on a diet. Really naughty is eating half a packet of those biscuits, walking back out, walking back in with your friend and going, oh, which greedy madam has eaten all of those? That's naughty. In Waterside and King's Oak, we describe behaviour as interesting or distressing. So if you've got interesting behaviour, you will be a bit sweary, a bit shouty, a bit spitty. You might pick something up and look like you're going to do something with it, but you're not going to do anything with it. And if it's distressing, it's normally when you've destroyed stuff, thrown things around the classroom, attempted to hurt yourself or others. And if you think of it in that way, rather than naughty, it starts to make a bit more sense. Because if they're talking to you by picking up a pencil and going, I'm going to stab you, then that tells you quite a lot about where that child is at that moment. Perhaps your lesson wasn't as fabulous as you thought it was. Just saying. So if you think of it as interesting and distressing, then that takes that whole naughty bit out of it. Now, that's a huge culture shift, especially for midday supervisors who love the word naughty. They really do. I had one in my previous school, Mrs. Bainbridge, and I don't care if she ever sees this video. Mrs. Bainbridge, I don't care. Mrs. Bainbridge was one of those midday supervisors who loved a tabard. But unfortunately, they didn't make a tabard that fitted Mrs. Bainbridge. And she liked one of those old green spelling books. There are people of the age group that I am. Those thin ones with the lines inside. And when you first went into like year 3 and 4, the teacher used to give you the most amazing task of writing the alphabet on each page so you could have your own dictionary. God, those were the days. Those were the days. If you're still doing that practice, well done you for being brave. She liked that, so she could write down your misdemeanours. And there was one child in particular called Stuart. And Stuart was just a beautiful child. Small, scraggly, not the best home life. Mum was one of those ladies who had a lot of gentlemen callers who appeared daytime, nighttime. And he called them uncle. Lots of them during the day and night time. And Stuart's biggest thing was to kick a ball. That's all Stuart ever wanted to do was kick a ball. And in my school at that time, there was a lovely white picket fence with a pond, with a grate over the top, so that if anybody decided to fling themselves in 1 inch of water, they weren't going to drown. And Stuart had this incredible ability to kick the ball over the fence every lunchtime and playtime, jump over the fence, come back covered in mud and goodness knows where else, and look as happy as anything. Mm-hmm. Mrs. Bainbridge, not so happy. And so every lunchtime play, he would be got in the little book. And depending on her legs, would depend on whether or not she could be bothered to walk up the corridor with him. So if it was a good day, you didn't see her because her legs were too hurting. If it was a bad day, then she'd walk up the corridor. And she would drag Stuart, who would be at this point snivelling and covered in mud, and dress him down in every way she possibly could in front of every adult that she would come across. It could be other teachers, it could be the gas man, it could be anybody. And she would drag him up to my office. Now, if those of you who are not at this exalted level of being executive, you don't realise how difficult it is to have a child interrupt your day because I've got so many more important things to do, like... Not sure, but there must be important things I have to do as an executive head. And she would drag him up and I could hear him coming up the corridor doing that sort of mixture of dolphin with a little bit of meerkat noise. You know, the... when they've gone past crying and there are no more tears and it's sore. You know it's sore and they're just making a noise now to let you know that they're there. And I could hear her as she dragged him up the corridor going, "You wait. You wait." She was very Welsh. I'm translating for you. This is a marvellous thing. "You wait. You wait till Mr. Griffiths sees you." And I'm sitting there with my computer thinking, I haven't had a wee. It's 12:30. I've been in this building since 6 a.m. I haven't got a warm cup of coffee. And I know what she's going to do. And she would drag him in and throw him. And then cross her arms. Well, sort of that. And then go, see what he's done, Mr. Griffiths. Oh, Stuart, you're a bit dirty. Why don't you pick up the ball, don't kick it back over the fence and go out and finish lunchtime play. Right, off you go. Walk down the corridor. I can hear you running, Stuart. Walk down the corridor. Lovely. Turn back computer and I can feel the evil behind my head. Is that it? Yes, that's it. Mrs. Bainbridge, you anything else? Don't look at the mess I'm making on my screen because I'm just typing around. And then at the end of school, she'd be outside with her friends, the women that she was controlling, and say things like, "Oh, no behaviour there, no idea what to do." She lasted another 3 weeks and then my life improved immensely after I'd sacked her. And I'm glad I sacked you, Mrs. Bainbridge. I hope you see this. I really do. Because she did the thing that you would hope that nobody would do to your children, which is ruin them. Why is it your God-given right to tell a child off for doing a thing that a child would do? What if your head teacher told you off for every time you've been told not to press the colour button on the photocopier, but you have? because the lady in the office has given you the code and is turning her eyes away. Or you've used all of the ink in your inkjet printer when you've got a lovely laser printer, which is cheaper to do per sheet, and you've printed it all out, and then you're borrowing your friend's printer and randomly sending stuff to any printer within your building until your head teacher's printer churns out a pile of stuff that you were hoping that they didn't want to see. We all do it. We all do things that are interesting. But why should we always be pulled up for it? If it's not going to hurt, if it's not going to kill anybody, are there better ways for us to do it? And that's what nurture and not nagging is all about. So my first thing, I should have put this up at the beginning, really, when you introduced me, Dawn, is not to panic. Because we panic a lot in schools about stuff. We panic about our data. We panic about our marking. We panic about our classrooms. We panic about the blink tests that will happen in our classrooms with the senior leadership coming around going, that one particular piece of target work is not quite in the right space in the plan that we sent out on the 1st of September. Get that all down, redo it, remark it, redo everything. We all panic, and there's no point. And when a child is displaying interesting or difficult behaviour, the last thing they want from you is for you to then say, oh, look at that, isn't it really scary? And drag the other 29 out of the classroom and leaving that child with nobody. What they're telling you when they're being interesting or distressing is that they need you. And if they are showing you that behaviour, they trust you. Now, I know that's difficult when they are screaming every expletive known to man at you and throwing things past your head, but it is the truth. If you think about your own home life, if you go home at the end of your school day and you are cross, who do you take it out on? I don't want to hear about children because that would do safeguarding, so can we keep that to ourselves? I am a DSL, I would be obliged, I don't want to know. You take it out on whoever's at home, don't you? You walk in and go, you will never believe my day today. And your other half is sitting there thinking, I have no idea what you're talking about, but I've learnt not to raise my head over the parapet because this is going to come out. And then you tell them about why you're cross. It's usually about something really, really, really small. Unless, of course, it's this, because only people in this room will understand what that does. That, as far as I'm concerned, breaks the Geneva Convention. That should be banned at all times, because you will have said the word, stop it! And it'll start again. And nobody outside of our profession understands what that does to us. Nobody. And you are right to be angry about that, you are right. But you take it out on the person that you know you will trust and will be able to hold you with your behaviours. So when a child is doing that, the last thing you need to do is go, oh, do you know what? I need to go and get the inclusion manager to come and have a little talk to you. Or you ring up the person on call in your corridor going, yeah, he's doing it again. Could you come get him? Because all that does is show that child you are not able to hold them. And the key phrase is hold them in mind. Because they need to know them, that you trust them, that you believe in them. Because nobody else has done that for them before. And if you can't do that, perhaps you need to question why you're in that room. Ooh, do you know what? I felt a change then. I'm of the age where, you know, I suddenly go warm for no reason. But now I'm feeling a little bit chilly, ladies and gents. But it's the truth. If you can't hold a child in mind, are you actually in the right profession? This leads me on to my big word of the day. I can see your face is excited by that. Pettifog. Everybody is responsible for behavioural management. It doesn't matter if you are the cleaner. It doesn't matter if you're the premises manager. Everybody has a responsibility for it. Now, that doesn't mean they've got the right to exclude. That doesn't mean that they've got the right to sit in at lunchtime. But that means that they've got the right to model the sort of behaviour you want to see in your school. So if you've got staff that walk up the corridor shouting their mouths off about something that's happened in somebody else's room, that's not really the sort of modelling you want to show. And that's not going to help people's mental well-being, because that person could be in a really tricky place at that time and you're not helping. Consistency with your approach for behaviour is the key. It doesn't matter if you've got the best behavioural policy in the world, which has got restorative justice and it's all very touchy-feely. It's not going to work if nobody's doing it. Likewise, if you've got the worst behavioural policy where you put kids in a cupboard or in a cage and you waterboard them for minor misdemeanours, except that one, because that one really does deserve waterboarding. As long as you all did that, it would have an impact. It's about the consistency of it. So think about your behaviour plans in school. Think about what you model to your children. How petty are you being? What is a pettifog, ladies and gents? Now, I'm Welsh. English is my second language. I know the word pettifog. It's an English word. Oh, gosh, it's gone very quiet. Hello? Oh, we are here. Lovely. No English specialist. No, I know there's an English specialist. I sat through yours, so I know you're an English specialist. No? Oh, dear. No magic wand for you, then. Pettifog is your battle, because you have to think about what you're trying to achieve. If in your classroom you have got lots and lots and lots of tiny low-level behaviours, they're not really low-level, because if you're noticing them, they are really in front of you. You have to deal with them. But some things you have to accept and some things you don't accept. What are your non-negotiables? So, for example, you've all sat staring at me while I've been talking. Some of you have fiddled with your pens, pretending you're writing something important down. Some of you have looked on your phone. Some of you have twiddled your hair. And some of you have stared blankly at me as if to say, I am engaged, but actually you're not. Am I supposed to make you do something different? I feel like I'm Doris Stokes this afternoon. Goodness me. If in your classroom you're expecting children to sit quietly without doing something while you're doing your big grand opus at the beginning, you are really misguided that they are going to sit there that quietly, unless, of course, you are amazing. And if you're amazing, I have jobs going. Most of us have to fiddle and do stuff in order to concentrate. We can't sit and look at somebody. It's uncomfortable. We're British. We don't stare at people. We don't talk to people, for goodness sake. So now you're expecting a small child to sit there being shock and awe while you're delivering something about decimals. And really, they're not going to be. And those children who are demonstrating interesting behaviours definitely aren't going to be. So why not give them something to fiddle with? I've given you a pot of dough disco dough. So if you were at early years, you might have heard of Jeanette Basson, who does a lot with dough disco dough. It's her invention. We use it at Waterside to give it to our kids to fiddle with so that they can concentrate. Now, you can use Play-Doh, blue tack. Don't buy those plastic fidgety spinner things, because they are really useful to be launched at your head by an SEMH child, and they have really good target practice availability. But that allows them to concentrate while you're talking to them. I give it to staff in staff meetings. I also give it to them when I'm having those very difficult conversations, because really I don't want them to throw anything at me and I'd like them to have something in their hand. But it also means that I look as if I'm really kind and caring, because I truly, really am. You also have to think about when you react to the behaviour that's in your classroom, are you reacting to it appropriately? So the tapping of the pencil, if you suddenly become a raving banshee, was that appropriate? Are you treating everybody in your room the same, or are you treating one lot of your children very differently to some of the others? So the ones that cause you grief, are you a little harder on than the ones that don't cause you so much grief? Have a little think about your own practice. Oh gosh, it's not going to go well. Now, I came from a very posh school where I was addressed as Sir by every member of the community. That wasn't instigated by me, that was just the sort of school it was. It was quite interesting to have Cherie Blair's boss introduce me as Sir to her husband, which was lovely. I was quite excited that I was that powerful. Since I've been at Waterside in King's Oak, I've been called a whole new vocabulary that I didn't know existed in the English language, because obviously I'm very sweet and innocent. And I could take some things personally. I've been called everything you can possibly imagine. If you haven't worked out, I am that rainbow in the corner. If you hadn't worked that out, ooh, really? Just saying. I've been called every version of that, and I could take it really personally, but I don't. I actually challenge it back in a really nice way, going, oh, well, you're right. You are so right. I do like doing that. That's amazing. How did you know? You can fill in the blanks yourselves, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not going to do that for you. We are all able to be hurt, though, by some things that children call us. And children have a really good ability to find that one thing that really does get to you. Now, I'm not going to do this in this forum, but I did do it when I first started to talk about behaviour, and I asked for people to tell me what things children had called them. And this one woman put her hand up, and she was very honest about how she was feeling. And she said, this child told me that my hair was ugly. And I looked at her and I forgot where I was. And told her that, yes, I can quite see that, because it does look like something you go trick-or-treating in. And then didn't stop, because I said, well, at least you weren't wearing Crocs as well. Oh. So I don't ask anymore. But there are things that children call you that do hurt you, but you can't take it personally. They are looking for a way of telling you that they need you. So if they're calling you fat, thin, skanky, manky, any other words you can think of. I'm being really good and not saying the words that I've been called recently. Don't take it personally. It's not you that they're getting at. It's the situation that they're in, and they may not have the vocabulary. Now, that said, some staff do take it really personally, and as a team, you need to look after that person. You know, it's not easy being called the things that you're called. You need to make certain that they've got time out, that they can have a cup of tea, that they can put themselves back in a place that they can go back in front of those children. Now, I've also given you a magic wand to go home with today, because as the head of behaviour, I'm always assumed that I have a magic wand to make children behave. I am like an Ed Psych. I walk into your classroom, they will behave. They will behave for the entire time that I sit in that classroom. I will sit there looking at that child that you've told me is the worst devil child you've ever seen. I walk out of that classroom and the entire world falls apart. They can smell it on me. I can't be in your classroom 24/7. So I can't wave a magic wand. But what I can do is help with your own well-being when those things happen. And so you've also got to go with your magic wand, a poster. And all around Waterside and King's Oak, we have wand therapy. Now, whenever I introduce wand therapy, people think I've gone mental. I haven't gone mental. This is a real therapy. You need a talking partner to go in with you, who you can trust. They will be given a timer and a magic wand. You have to go somewhere that you feel safe enough to talk. It can't be in the cupboard in your classroom, because the children will know where you've gone, and it also starts a whole set of rumours that perhaps you really do not want to have set off. And we have them in the staff room, we have them in the toilets, we have them in some of the resource areas which are away from the classrooms. And you go in and you shut the door and they set the timer to 3 minutes. They click start and you can rant. You can let it all out. But the person who's got the magic wand and the timer can't interact with you. They can't talk, they can't nod, they can't say a thing. And it is really hard for you to rant for 3 minutes solidly without somebody joining in. It is really hard when you're the person with the wand and the timer as well, because you really want to say stuff and you can't. You can't. If they get bored listening to you rant, they wave the magic wand and tell you to get over it. And that is it. It stops. If you manage to get to 3 minutes, you are a better whinger than I am. I have tried. I've got to 2 minutes and 30. And then I heard myself. I heard how stupid I was sounding and then stopped. It's really cathartic to do that in front of my deputy. I've now given him a lot of ammunition against me when I've dragged him into a cupboard. God, that really doesn't sound good. But I have dragged him into a cupboard and we have done one. No, that doesn't sound good either. When we have completed... No. When I have let go of the things that I need to let go of, he now knows a lot more about me than he thought. But actually, for him, it's actually empowered him to understand what leadership feels like. But also for me, when I've had staff come to do that to me because they've needed to whinge, I found out what some of the decisions I've made have had an impact on them, and I didn't realise it would have that impact, and we could change things around. You have a poster to go home with as well. Gosh, I'm so good to you. So... the script at Waterside and at King's Oak is all about being able to deal with behaviour when it's really challenging. And I'm only going to quickly go through this because we've got other stuff to get to. But you've got to remember that when you're talking to somebody who's being interesting, you can't have a conversation. That's not where you're at. You have to repeat the things that you need to happen in short, snappy sentences. I don't need you to shout. I don't need you to shout. I know you're angry. I don't need you to shout. The more conversation you have, the worse it becomes. The unicorn in the room is you, because you have to remember that you may be the person causing that problem. And you have to be big enough to say, I am the person that's causing the problem, and somebody else has to take over for you. That's not a sign of weakness. What you're saying to that child is, do you know what? I know you're angry with me. I get this. So Miss is going to come or Sir is going to come, but I'm coming back afterwards. And you have to go back. If you don't go back and make that relationship back with them, then that relationship dies. They need to know you're not frightened of them, that you understand that they're angry, you understand that they were cross. It could be over the tiniest thing, because it usually is. But you have to go back and rebuild that relationship. If you can't do that, then that's a really big question to ask yourself. Because you would hope that they would come back and do that to you when they've upset you. We always make them go and apologise to grown-ups. Why can't we go back and apologise to them? Now, I'm going to whiz through to Julie Andrews. Now, Julie teaches you do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do in that order. But about 5 minutes into the song, because you haven't got the full 5 minutes of that, she then mixes it up to prove that you can sing any song, because you just need to know the notes to sing. Because if you know the notes to sing, you can sing anything. Yes? So it's the same for behaviour. So if managing your expectations isn't working, then try something else. If that isn't working, then try simplifying your requests. If you've got to get them all to fiddle and do something on a carpet first, then do that. There is no right or wrong. It's about moving it round. Now, you may think for the past 38 minutes that I have been completely mental, and probably I am. But there is a reason why I show you all of this, because the results are the important bit. Now, when Waterside started, as you can see, there's some of my beautiful superheroes, our data was really interesting. So our incidents in 2015 to 2016 were huge. Anything that's red meant that there was violence. And more often than not, I had the paramedics at my building dealing with either children or staff. I am not proud of the fact that the school I took over had staff that took their teeth home in jiffy bags. I am not proud of the fact that my beautiful superhero TA, Mrs. Olive, had her fingers broken because somebody kept slamming a door on them. Not proud of that at all. What I am proud of is that after we had changed how Waterside looked, how our expectations changed and how our aggression went right down. And now we're marking aggression as if they're using foul language to us, not physical aggression, because we don't get physically aggressed in school at all. That's come from being part of Julie. We've looked at our exclusion data, and you can see that when I took over in 2015-16, and you have to remember that Waterside is an SEMH school. So if I exclude them, where did they go? Nobody would have them. We excluded 288 days. And when you think that the cohort of that school is 40, that is a lot of children not being in school. Over the course of the few years that I've been there, we're now at a point that we've not excluded anybody. It's ridiculous because I could move them into the classroom that deals with exclusion, but what's the point? I need to deal with their behaviours. That's down to being happy and productive and proactive about their behaviours, because we know that they're going to do something, so why are we scared when it happens? We should be ready for it. The important bit is staff absence, because when I took over, that was huge. Staff were disaffected. A lot of staff were ill, usually on a Monday or a Friday, and staff generally were hurt and off work because they had been damaged. And you can see that the red line wasn't particularly something I'm proud of, but the blue line I really am, because my staff drag themselves in. I have to send them home if they're not well enough to actually teach that day, but they will come in and they will work with our kids. My attendance data is ridiculous for an SEMH school because it's not far off the national expectation. And there are a lot of schools in Greenwich that would like 94%. I'm really proud of the fact that my kids want to come to school. And actually the parents want them to be in school, mainly because they can get rid of them for 6 hours, but they also want them in school to learn. And finally, the important bit, Ender Key Stage 2 SATs. Because people forget that a special school still has to follow the national curriculum. I'm judged exactly the same way under Ofsted as you are in mainstream. The vast majority of mine either meet national expectation or exceed, and this year, my entire year six cohort are on track to completely exceed national expectation and get that lovely core subject indicator that I've been desperate to get for them. They are bright, intelligent children, the ones that play up in your classes. They've just missed a lot of school. And if you can put that back into them, they will really pay you back in dividends. Ridiculously, in our last Ofsted, I have now got to show that I'm accommodating gifted and talented within an SEMH school because my data is foxed Ofsted. As an SEMH school, I am supposed to be at the bottom of the pile. I'm number 16 out of all of the primaries in Greenwich. That's annoyed all of the academy trusts. And I am the top within the SEMH in UK because my kids achieve. And they achieve because my staff want them to be there and they want them to achieve. If you haven't heard of Reading Wise, I don't get any money for Reading Wise at all. But we bought into Reading Wise 18 months ago, which is an electronic reading support device. We've given them all it on a Kindle. It's moved our reading ages dramatically, and not just their age, but their comprehension. We're on average now getting a minimum of 3 years progress. I've just done my last data drop. I'm so sorry that your data drops aren't exciting, but my data drop this time shows that there are eight kids in my building that have made 5 years progress in the last 8 months. And they have full comprehension. And I've NGR'd it, I've done it all. I've tried to prove it's wrong. And I can't prove it's wrong, it's worked. If you've not bought into it, please, please go and have a look. If you want to come and see how it works with the most complicated, come and see it at ours. I'd like to thank you for allowing me to give you a really quick whistle-stop tour this afternoon. If you'd like to come and visit, please, please do, because we'd be more than happy to let you in. Just don't turn up, because we won't let you through the door. Mainly because that's for your own safety. Of where we are, but if you get in touch with us, we are more than happy to show you what we do and give you our work. So thank you for your time this afternoon.